Okay, we're on.
Thank you.
Church. This is the fourth Sunday of Easter, Good Shepherd Sunday. We pray that our worship would be a blessing for you. Our first hymn is number 864, Shepherd of Tender Youth. We struggle to be confident in your presence and protection. When life is going great and we stand above those who oppose us, we gloat in our own intelligence and abilities, forgetting the one who gives every blessing in our lives. As we walk through this broken world, we overlook the goodness and mercy that flows into our lives from you. Forgive us, good shepherd. Our good shepherd, Jesus Christ, has come to save us, to give his life for us. He dies to pay for all of our sins and rises again to give us life. I announce his grace to you. In the stead and by the command of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I am the good shepherd. make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. Since you have wakened from death the shepherd of your sheep, grant us your Holy Spirit, that when we hear the voice of our shepherd, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. First reading for the fourth Sunday of Easter is from Acts chapter 2. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers, and awe came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all, as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The epistle from 1 Peter chapter 2. For this is a gracious thing, when, mindful of God, one endures sorrow while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if, when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life. Have it upon them." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our hymn number 710, The Lord's My Shepherd, I Will Not Want. From our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I heard a sad story this past week. It was about a family, mom and dad, and some kids, and they were really looking forward to getting their stimulus check. But when the time they were expecting it passed and they checked their bank account, there was nothing there. So they did a little bit of poking around and they discovered that somebody else had gotten their money. Somebody else the previous year had somehow gotten a hold of a social security number, filed a fraudulent tax return, and so when the government went to send the money to their bank account, it went to somebody else's bank account. They were really counting on that, really anticipating that. A sad story, but all too common. How many of us haven't had somebody get into a bank account or into a credit card? Or into some of our personal information. And you know, if it's not you sitting down with the login and the password, If somebody else is doing it, if they're getting into your stuff some other way, they're not there to do something for you. They're there to take something away from you. They're there to steal. They're there to take away from you what should be yours. It's really interesting that Jesus even spoke to this thousands of years ago. In John chapter 10, the gospel lesson today, where Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber." That man is not there to take care of you. He is there to take something away from you. Now, of course, Jesus is not talking about finances. He's not talking about your personal information. He's talking about your faith. It's easy to find that harmful spiritual ideas, philosophy, guidance, direction have crept their way into our lives. And these things are not good for us. And so Jesus gives us a very easy, usable way to discern what's legit and what's not. He very clearly says, "I am the door. I am the door of the sheep. Anything that is coming into your life that is not connected with what Christ has done for you, or any response that is not based on what Christ has done for you, is not going to be good spiritual information. It's going to take away from who Christ is and what he's done for you, and it's going to take away with what he has for you, for the blessings he has for you." And our lives, really, our world is filled with all kinds of false shepherds, so to speak. I'm not talking just about people, but motivation, inspiration, philosophies, ideas, they're all around us. And sometimes they sound pretty good, and sometimes we buy right into them. Sometimes we'll find ourselves talking about doing the right thing, doing the ethical thing, doing a moral thing, doing the wise thing. But not because of who we are in Christ, but because we just know this is the right thing to do, which leads us down a deceptive path. We're depending on our own rightness or righteousness, which certainly isn't the path we want to go down. Christ is our righteousness by faith. And we build our morals and our ethics and our choices on who he is and what he's done for us. Another thing that subtly slips in is the temptation to consider all different forms of religious belief as equivalent. You know, Jesus is one of those approaches, but people believe other things. And we're very hesitant to condemn other systems of belief. That kind of universalism, though, takes away from Jesus being the one and only Son of God and what he did for us at the cross. Sometimes the trap is just one of self-sufficiency. I can do it. I can take care of myself. I don't need anybody's help. And of course, that's not who God created us to be. What about the sufficiency we have in Christ? He's the one who gives us life and breath and everything that we have. So they're subtle, but you can tell they just don't quite fit the mold. They're not coming into our lives through Christ, and we're not responding through Christ. We're someplace else, which means these things are not going to be good for us. These are the kinds of things that John says steal and kill and destroy God's people. You know, the context of what John records here for us is very interesting. It comes on the heels of John chapter 9. And we read that chapter in Lent, not too many months ago, where a man is born blind and his disciples want to know what's going on. Did he sin? Did his parents do something wrong? Why is this man blind, Jesus? And Jesus says it has nothing to do with that. This man is blind so that you can see the work of God in his life. And Jesus makes some mud, puts it on his eyes. The man rinses the mud off, and he can see. What a wonderful miracle. What a wonderful expression of God's grace for this man and for those who witnessed it. But then the Pharisees come, and they discredit the man. Well, he's just a sinner. What does he know? And then they discredit Christ. Well, he doesn't keep the Sabbath. He doesn't hold to our traditions. We don't even know where he came from. And by rejecting Jesus in that way, they reveal themselves to be the very robbers and thieves that Jesus was talking about. Climbing into somebody's life in a different way, excluding Christ, and taking away, robbing and killing and destroying the lives that Jesus came to save. Jesus came to pour out his love into their lives, and they were taken away. And so Jesus often warned his disciples, watch out for them. They are mixing in some leaven, some yeast into the dough that you really don't want to be a part of your life. Jesus says, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. A genuine, legitimate shepherd shows up at the gate. The gatekeeper knows him. The sheep know him. He knows them. They listen to him. He leads them to a place where they have what they need, something to eat and some water. He leads them back home to a safe place at night. He takes care of them. But it all comes through the door. There's no other way in that is legitimate. A great example, a great comparison might be this. If you saw somebody out in the parking lot trying to hotwire a car, you would probably assume they were up to no good, right? The person who should be in that car is the one who has the key. You could start it up and drive it. Not somebody messing around with tools and screwdrivers and wires. In the same way, if somebody's trying to access the lives of God's people, in some other way than through Christ, something's not right. Something's wrong. The legitimate shepherd is always going to lead the sheep, lead people to Christ. He's always going to build off of what Christ has done. He's not going to resort to philosophy, psychology, manipulation, extravagant promises. It's always going to be about Jesus. He's going to make sure that they know there is no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. There is nobody else who is righteous, who can die that innocent death on the cross for our sins. Jesus is the only one. He'll make sure that they know that no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. He's the one God promised to send. He's the one who fulfills the promises. He's the one who fully atones for sin and rises again from the dead. There is nobody else that can overcome sin and death and the power of Satan like Jesus. He'll make sure that they know that Christ has come to give them life, abundant life. Christ does not come to take anything from us or demand anything from us, but instead he pours out his life. He gives us everything he has. He comes to give us life. Hopefully all of these things sound familiar to you. Hopefully you've heard these things before. And you recognize them as things that Jesus himself taught, as truths about our Savior Jesus. And it is so good to know his voice. It is so good to recognize what he has said. Because sometimes you're going to hear something that sounds right, but you're going to get the sense that it's not quite on track. And that's why you always want to know the voice of our Lord. Let me give an example. I was at a workshop not too long ago, kind of training workshop, and before one of the sessions, the leader gave a devotion, and she said this line. I think it's a quote from a book, but I'm not positive. But I jotted it down. She said, God will never do for you what you can do for yourself. Okay, this is what she said. God will never do for you what you can do for yourself. Which sounds good. I mean, it sounds like a good thing. And what she was using this to help you understand, God gave you his word, but you've got to sit down and read it. But it just didn't sound right. It tasted more like legalism than grace, and I just couldn't put my finger on it until, really, just this past week as I was thinking about it. This is what came to me. That's not what love looks like. And Christ embodies God's love. You know, this is love. Not that we love God, but he loved us and gave us his son. Love sometimes does for you what you could very easily do yourself. In a relationship, you don't say, well, get your own drink. You know, you got two legs, you can go. Love brings a drink over to a person who could get it for themselves. But you just love to do that for them. We do things for each other because that's what love looks like. And the pages of Scripture are filled with God doing things for people that they could very well do themselves. Abraham and Sarah could figure out a way to have a son, but God said, no, I want to give you the gift of a son who will be your heir. God's people could have picked out a king, but God said, no, I want to give you a king, like David, somebody after my own heart. The disciples could have washed their own feet, but Jesus said, no, I want to wash your feet because I love you that much, and I want you to understand that God loves to do things for you that you could do yourself. That's part of the relationship. That's part of who we are. See, Christ is the key to just about everything. There's a lot in the Bible that's hard to understand. There's a lot in the Bible that's confusing. It's culturally foreign to us. The language is hard to understand. But when you read it, and you study it, and you think about it, in the shadow of the cross of Jesus Christ, it starts to come together. It starts to make sense. The promises of the Old Testament, the worship of the Old Testament, the commands of the Old Testament become real and living in the person of Christ. And then you start to see what God has in mind. The Proverbs and the songs and psalms of celebration and sometimes the warnings all become very real when you see them show up in the life of Jesus. He's the key to making sense out of everything that God has promised and everything that God has done for us. It is so great. It is such a blessing to have the words of our Lord echoing in our minds and in our hearts and in our lives. Because there's nothing real like hearing the voice of your shepherd. There's nothing really like him saying your name and knowing who you are. There's really nothing like following him with absolute confidence that he's going to get you to where you need to go and where he wants you to be. Paul spoke about this in lots of places in his epistles. He said, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of Christ. Christ helps it all make sense, and that gospel calls us into faith by the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, if anyone hears what I says and they put it to practice, there's the wisdom that makes you somebody building a house on a rock. No matter what happens, your life will be secure. The Apostle Paul said, I'm not going to use a whole bunch of fancy arguments. I'm only going to tell you about one thing, Christ and him crucified. Because when you have that, everything else falls into place. You're being led into a place of life, abundant life. I pray that that's what I have done. I pray that I do that each and every Sunday. Not taking you, trying to get you to God in any other way, but through Christ and what he has done for us. In this time of uncertainty, we certainly do need guidance, direction, reassurance, and hope. And guess what we find when a shepherd leads us through the door of Jesus Christ? We discover, we obtain life, abundant life. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Lord, for the life that we have in Christ. Thank you for the door that always leads us to life. Jesus Christ. In his name. Bidden by your shepherd, let us come before his throne of grace in prayer on behalf of all people according to their needs. Blessed shepherd, you established your church with your sacrificial death and mighty resurrection. Grant us devotion that we may abide in the teaching of the apostles and honor the fellowship of the church. Guard us against all enemies of your word. Keep us within the care of your flock and staff forevermore. Mighty shepherd, you hold in your hands all the might of man, and you hold accountable those who govern us. Give us good government and good leaders who honor your purposes, protect your people, serve the cause of justice, and defend our liberty against all threats. Give them wisdom and moderation in their pandemic response, Lord. Lord, you loved us enough so much to shed your blood, and you want all to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Inspire and equip your church that we faithfully speak your word and bless all those who serve in this church on your behalf. Bless us when we are persecuted. Bless us when we suffer for the sake of the good that honors you. Bless us when we are obedient and follow your ways, Lord. Lord, your wounds bring us healing, and your voice calls us to you in time of need. We pray that you would especially bless with your healing Nikki and Nova, Bill Minich and Tim, Erica, and we thank you, Lord, for our good surgery for Chris, and we pray for good recovery in these next few weeks. Thank you for the blessings that the doctors have brought to him. Give your comfort to the family of Carol Sauter, as they mourn the death of a nephew, and also to the Denby family as they mourn Don's death. Heavenly Father, you have not withheld anything from us, but emptied yourself fully on the cross so that we can be saved. Move our hearts to such devotion and teach us generosity, that with everything we bring it from a grateful heart, and we bring it to serve others with the love you've given us. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for our worship in our homes and when we are able to gather together as your church. Bless our worship as we serve you and love our neighbors and take care of our families. Thank you, Lord, for all your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Our closing hymn, number 711, Savior Like a Shepherd. Man.